Harper Audio presents The Color of Lightning by Paulette Jiles. Performed by Jack Garrett. Copyright 2009 by Paulette Jiles. Production copyright 2009 by HarperCollins Publishers. Chapter 1. When they first came into the country, it was wet and raining. And if they had known of the droughts that lasted for 7 years at a time, they might never have stayed. They did not know what lay to the west. It seemed nobody did. Sky and grass and red earth, as far as they could see. There were belts of trees in the river bottoms, and the remains of old gardens, where something had once been planted and harvested, and then the fields abandoned. There was a stone circle at the crest of a low ridge. Moses Johnson was a stubborn and secretive man who found statements in the minor prophets that spoke to him of the troubles of the present day. He came to decisions that could not be altered. He read aloud, "Therefore thus saith the Lord, ye have not hearkened unto me in proclaiming liberty, every one to his own brother, and every man to his neighbor. Behold, I proclaim a liberty for you, saith the Lord, to the sword, to the pestilence, and to the famine. And I will make you to be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth." That's in Jeremiah, he said. So they left Burkett Station, Kentucky, in 1863, in 4 wagons, 15 white people and 5 black, including children, to get away from the war between armies, and also the undeclared war between neighbors. Britt Johnson was proud of his wife, and he loved her, and was deeply jealous of her because of her good looks and her singing voice, and her unstinting talk and laughter. Her singing voice. All along their journey from Kentucky to North Texas, he had been afraid for her. Afraid that some white man or black or Spaniard would take a liking to her, and he would have to kill him. He rode a gray saddle horse, always within sight of the wagon that carried her and the children. She was as much of grace and beauty as he would ever get out of Kentucky. Before they crossed the Mississippi at Little Egypt, they stopped. And there, at the heel of the Free State of Illinois, Moses Johnson caused Britt's manumission papers to be drawn up and notarized by a shabby, consumptive justice of the peace, who looked as if these papers were the last ones he would notarize before he died from sucking in the damp malarial air and the smoke of a black cigar. The justice of the peace said it was a shame to manumit the man. Look at what a likely buck he was. A great big strong nigger. And Moses Johnson said, "You are going to meet your maker before long, sir. You will meet him with tobacco on your breath and smelling of the Indian devil weed. And what will you say to him who is the author of your being? You will say, 'Yes, I did my utmost to keep a human being in the bonds of slavery and robbed of his liberty. And moreover, I spent my precious breath a-smoking of filthy black cigars.' Here is the lawyer's signature on his papers and his wife's papers as well. You will have your clerk copy all of these and then deposit the copies in the Pulaski County Courthouse." And from there, they went on to Texas. You could raise cattle anywhere in that country. At that time, there was very little mesquite or underbrush. Just the blue stem and the grama grasses and the low curling buffalo grass and the wild oats and buckwheat. When the wind ran over it, they all bent in various yielding flows, with the wild buckwheat standing in islands, stiff with its heads of grain and red branching stems. The lower creek bottoms were like parks, with immense trees and no underbrush. The streams ran clearer than they do now. The grass held the soil in tight fists of roots. The streams did not always run, but here and there were water holes whose edges were cut up with hoof marks of javelina and buffalo and sometimes antelope. Ducks flashed up off the surface and skimmed away in their flight patterns of beating and sailing, beating and sailing. Mary had been raised in the main house with old Mrs. Randall, who was blind in one eye, and she had not wanted to come to Texas, even on the promise of her freedom. Britt said he would make it up to her. As soon as the country was settled and the war was over, he would start in as a freighter. He would break in a team from some of the wild mustangs that ran loose in the plains. There had to be a way to catch them. Then he would buy heavy horses. And then they would have a good house, and a big fenced garden, and a cook stove, and a kerosene lamp. The people who had come from Burkett Station built their houses with large stone fireplaces and chimneys. They rode out into the country to explore. The tall grass hissed around the horses' legs like spray. Feral cattle ran in spotted and elusive herds, their horns as long as lances, splashed in red and white, and some of them dotted like clown cattle. They had come to live on the very edge of the great rolling plains, with the forested country behind them and the empty lands in front. Long, attentive lines of timber ran like lost regiments along the rivers and creeks. Everything was strange to them, the cactus and all its hooked varieties, the elusive antelope in white bibs and black antlers, the red sandstone dug up in plates to build chimneys and fireplaces big enough to get into in case there was a shooting situation. There were nearly 50 black people in Young County now. Britt said soon they could have their own church and their own school. Mary was silent for a moment as the thought struck her, and then cried out. She could be the Elm Creek teacher. She could teach children to sing their ABCs and recite Bible verses. For instance, how the people were freed from Babylon in Isaiah. Britt nodded and listened as he stood in the doorway. Mary planned the school and the lessons aloud and at length, and lit the fire and sang and talked and made up rhymes for the children that had been born to them. Jim, the oldest, and Jube, who was 9, and Cherry, age 5, who had wavy hair like her mother. She told the children stories of who they were, that their great-grandfather had been brought from Africa, from a place called Benin, and that he was the son of a great king there, taken captive when he was 10, because he saw in the distance a waving red silk flag and had gone to see who was waving it in such an inviting way. He had sung a certain song he wanted all his descendants to remember, but it had been forgotten. From time to time, Mary said she dreamed about Kentucky and the rain there, and her mother and her aunts. She dreamed that she and Britt and the children had gone home. Britt tried not to favor Jim over the other two, but already at age 11, the boy was both manly and kind. Jim bent over the pages of the Bible by firelight, entranced by words like reigneth and strode. His mother made him spell them out. That spring, Jim rode with his father, searching out the wild cattle that grazed along the clear fork of the Brazos, and when they came upon buffalo, they sat on their horses and watched them, looking for some clue as to their nature. One of the white men who had lived in the country for 10 years led them to see a herd moving north in the cold spring rain. They were dark and woolly and stood high at the shoulder. They moved down the slopes of the Brazos Valley, wreathed in their own steam and water dripping from their half-moon horns, free and untended. No human beings owned them or directed their movement. They went where they meant to go in their own minds. They spread to the bald horizon under a drifting animal mist, and they smelled good. I wonder if they have regular teeth, said Moses. Like cows, said Old Man Peeveler. They just have regular teeth like cows. How do they eat? They eat very well, the tongue especially. Young Jim wanted to ride down among them, but Britt laid his hand on the boy's forearm and shook his head. A calf turned to stare at them. It was a bright, rusty red. Its mother turned and called to it, and the calls from the herd of thousands in low, explosive grunts made a ceaseless web of sound as the herd made their way north by the notions they held unspoken and secret, some ageless living map written out invisibly in their hearts. They turned back toward Elm Creek. Old Man Peeveler had been in the country a long time and carried the scar of an arrow wound in his neck. The red men live in the north, he told them, past the West Fork of the Trinity and on beyond the Red River, which is 4 days' ride north of here. That is their land, and this is their raiding country. They raid for fun. The young men love it. Then they ride back north across the Red, and they are safe there. So keep your firearms loaded and to hand. And so they stayed. In Kentucky, there was nothing but war and no safe place. To the north and west were the wild Indian lands of plain and canyon. Now that they had arrived, they found that there was no other place to go. There was no retreat. No going back. Britt worked for Old Man Peeveler, driving freight, carrying supplies from Weatherford over the rolling prairies to Fort Belknap and Concho, supplies to the Ledbetter Salt Works. This way he learned the roads and the freighting business. The men at these places told him that he should be careful. But Moses Johnson said he hadn't seen a red man since they had arrived. Judge Wilson said it was true. There had been some kind of Indians close by at some time, but he did not know of what persuasion they were. And they were gone now, and with nearly 200 civilized people in the county, it was not likely they would return. They were alone now. All those who had come from Burkett Station, Kentucky, were alone. Each family in its own house, on the ocean of grass. Their cabin windows sparked in the night, like the distant ports of small craft on unfamiliar seas. They were not sure what lay to the north and west. Perhaps some veiled landscape or nation of people who had once owned the land where they themselves now lived. But these people were gone and were not coming back. Britt lay down his tin shears and listened. It was a heavy, dark night, with a haze about the three-quarter moon, hot and close. The dog stood up and stalked slowly into the yard, with the fur of his back rising hair by hair. Mary and the children were asleep. The trumpet vine crawled down over the doorway, and in it some persistent ticking insect clocked the seconds. Britt stepped to one side of the open door, into the shadow where he could not be seen, with a half-made candle sconce in his hands. A wind came up out of the grasslands and moved down into the valley of Elm Creek and rattled the cottonwood leaves over the cabin. The dog stood stiff-legged, staring at the far bluff of the creek where the stone circle was. A man stood there. In the blue moonlight, Britt could see that the top half of his face was painted black. His hair drifted in the wind. Then he was gone. The morning of October 13, 1864, Britt bridled his team of horses. The men were going to Weatherford for supplies and a few other things like hard candy and Mrs. Fitzgerald's hair dye. There are no mornings anywhere, like mornings in Texas. Before the heat of the day, the world suspended as if it were early morning in paradise, and fading stars like night watchmen walking the periphery of darkness and calling out that all is well. Mary's lessons, scraped clean from the thin boards, and bread baking in a skillet. Britt came in and took up a smoking hot triangle of cornbread from the skillet and lifted it to his mouth. Then he bent forward with a confused expression to a piece of paper lying on the clothes trunk.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.